We are commanded to, are you ready for this? Are you ready? Serve one another. We are commanded to serve one another. Now, you already know, don't you? You already know right now if you're pretty good at serving other people. You know it. Because some of you are like, oh, yeah, this sermon's going to be good because I'm already doing it. But some of you already, when I just said serve one another, you're like, seriously? Because this may be something you struggle with. Now, let me say this. Because that's just a given, what I just said. There's a whole other category of people in the room right now. You would say, yes, I am that person. I'm serving. Look at me. You know, hey, Kent, give me the gold star for the day. But here's what's happening with you. Do you know that it is possible for you to be serving the Lord and at the same time have a little bit of a jaded attitude about doing that? Do you know that? And if that is the case, you probably should say, man, is that even God's plan? I don't get this. Why do I find myself serving? Because I know that's what the Lord wants me to do. But at times I have a little bit of a jaded attitude about doing that. So I thought, let's just start with kind of like, you know, the obvious. Let me start you before we go into the New Testament with Psalm 100. Psalm 100 verse 2, which tells us this. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful songs. Serve the Lord with gladness. That's an old hymn I used to sing at the church I grew up in. Y'all remember that one? Serve the Lord with gladness. You know, I can envision my dad up there doing the dun, 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 dun. That's what music directors used to do. Serve the Lord with gladness. But for some of us, if you're in the room today and you're a little bit exhausted, you're tired, you're overwhelmed, you're overcommitted, and you find yourself having zero margin in your life, like some of you don't even know how to slow down. For some people, it's really hard for you to ever say no to anything or anybody. And so when you do serve, there is no joy in it. There is no serving the Lord with gladness. And on the inside, while you might put on a really good mask, you may be a little bit bitter about it. You might be a little critical about it. You possibly could be putting on what I would call like a little bit of a martyr syndrome when you're serving others. Now, the good news is the Bible is absolutely incredible and speaks to all this. There's an amazing chapter in the New Testament book of Mark. And like Mark, I'm going to read you some of Mark chapter 10. I'm going to summarize some of it. But like it's incredible. Just in this one chapter of the New Testament, Mark chapter 10, there's this fascinating dialogue as Jesus is teaching. And in the first part of Mark chapter 10, he jumps in and Jesus starts teaching us about marriage and about divorce. And I know there's some married people in the room right here, right now. Let me just put this out there. Would you say that this is a group participation warning. Here we go. I'm wanting you to respond to me. Would you say that if you're married, it's kind of important for you to learn how to serve one another? Yes. Oh, thank you. Good, good, good. So Jesus talks about that. And then he jumps from that teaching. He starts talking about children. Let the little children come into me. And then he starts talking about the importance of serving children. Well, of course, we get that. Absolutely. Then here comes the rich man who comes to Jesus with all kinds of questions. He's struggling. He's struggling to understand what it really means to be a disciple. And you know what Jesus says to him. And hey, you gotta let go of all this. You gotta leave it all. Give it away. Well, is that serving? Hello. Because most of us, last time I checked, don't really want to give it all away. You know, we would rather look at how our bank account is getting bigger instead of doing something intentionally to make it smaller by giving it away, serving. And then all of a sudden in verse 32 of Mark chapter 10, there's this transition. And Jesus, he predicts to his disciples his death. This is now the third time that he's tried to help them understand. The disciples, however, are not really understanding when Jesus says this once again. And to allow you to see how they're not understanding, what happens then, James and John, they start asking for a favor on the heels of that. Hey, Jesus, you know, we were just thinking, When you become the king, when you enter into your kingdom, we were wondering if it might be possible for us to be the guys who sit next to you on your throne. Now, sometimes when we read scripture, I would love for there to be, you know, like, hey, click here to watch the video of what Jesus' face looked like as he said this. I want that. And so my imagination goes wild, and I'm thinking at this point, Jesus is perhaps just like shaking his head and just saying under his breath, guys, come on. Like, I need you to listen up. I've tried to help you understand this 3 times now. You're not understanding. And it's like he's trying to communicate, time is not on our side. And look what Jesus said to the disciples in this moment. Mark chapter 10, verses 44 and 5. He says, disciples, church, whoever wants to become great among you will be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you will be a slave to all. For even, now he's speaking of himself, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but he came to serve and to give up his life as a ransom for many. And I read that text, and to all of us, man, it just jumps off the page saying, yes, like this is it. The Son of God, Jesus Christ, he came to serve and to give up his life by ultimately going to the cross. Now, we know that. Yet when we compare that to what is playing out in our world today all around us, it seems that all we hear are screams of individuals saying, give me some attention. Listen to my perspective. Listen to my thoughts. Understand what I'm trying to say. And in light of what our world is crying out, I'm just asking this question. Who in our world today might be willing to make it a priority to give up their life as a humble servant? Who wants to do that? Who is willing to serve others in a sacrificial way? Because if you think about it, the truth is this. Not many people want to do that. Number one, there's no fame in it. There's no money in it. There's no status in it. There's no popularity in it. And yet Jesus makes this incredibly bold statement in Mark chapter 10. And he says to the church, he says to you and I, hey, if you want to be great, it all begins with you being a servant. And it makes absolutely no sense to the majority of people in our world today. And it did not make sense to the first century Christians. I say that because I want to ask you to look at this letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the Galatians. And he's talking about the same thing. Galatians chapter 5, Paul writes to the church, and he is reminding them of something really important. He's saying, brothers and sisters, now that you are followers of Jesus Christ, now that you are his disciples, he says in Galatians 5:13, you have freedom. You have freedom. Look at the text with me, Galatians 5:13. For you are called to be free, brothers and sisters, but here's the warning. Only don't use this freedom, Paul says, as an opportunity for the flesh, but instead, here it is, the focus of what we're talking about today, but instead, Paul says to all of us, serve one another. Serve one another and do this through love. Now that word freedom for most people is a very slippery slope. Many people would say that freedom means, oh man, I can just go out and do whatever I want to do. I can do anything at all. There are no consequences. It doesn't matter. I can do anything at all. But biblical freedom means this. Biblical freedom means you now have liberty from illegitimate bondage so that you can enjoy this new relationship you have with your Heavenly Father. And so here we are. We call ourselves disciples. We're followers of Jesus Christ. And as disciples of Jesus, we have been empowered to fulfill our God-ordained purpose in life. Every one of us in this room, every one of you. God has a plan and a purpose for your life, everything you do. And Paul, what he's doing, he's saying to the church who's struggling with this, just like many of us struggle with it, hey, don't use this freedom you have been given as an opportunity to like fulfill your desires for sin. Don't use this as an opportunity to fulfill your desires for the flesh, because the truth is, that's how we all got in trouble in the first place, right? That's kind of where it all started. But Paul says, I want you to know that, he points us back to the cross, because Jesus gave his life on the cross, I mean, which is the ultimate gift of serving. It's the ultimate act of service. Because of that, because Jesus gave up his life as a ransom, you are now free from this bondage of sin. So what does all this look like? How do we live this out? It's right there in Galatians 5:13, the last part of that verse. So we serve one another through love. We serve one another through love. Biblical love, biblical servanthood, is this decision to compassionately and righteously and sacrificially seek the well-being of another person. Putting others first. Putting others before yourself. Jesus talked about it. Jesus said, just as I have served others, he says, we are to love and serve in the same way. We are to be like Christ. I shared this verse, I think, in the first week of the series and maybe even in last week, John 13:34. Let me just remind you again. Jesus says, hey, I'm giving you a new command. You are to love one another. Just as I have loved you, Jesus says, you are to love one another. By this, here's the deal. Here's how everyone is going to know that you're my disciples, if you love one another. And so I think about this, you think about this. Here's, at the end of the day, here's the question. If Jesus Christ, our Savior, if he who is the Son of God served us through love, why then, as one of his disciples, would we be expected to do anything less than that? We are clearly called to serve one another. Many of you, you know the story of the Good Samaritan, right? Just say yes. Thank you. You know it. You learned it. I joke about the felt board where they used to put the little pictures of the biblical characters on the board. Y'all, here's the deal. You have no idea. This year, for my birthday, my daughter Macy was at a thrift store and found a felt board with hundreds of characters. Almost brought it out today, but I'm holding out. I'm going to bring it out. But I learned the story of the Good Samaritan as my Sunday school teacher put the pictures in, you know, amazing, right? You know the story. I want to share, that's all about serving, right? And so I want to share a quote with you from Dr. Martin Luther King talking about that biblical story. He said this, you know what happened. Dr. King said, the first question which the priest and the Levite, they're the guys who pass by on the other side, right? The first question they asked was this: if I stop to help this man, what will happen to me? Yet, think about this. The Good Samaritan was the one who reversed that question. If I do not stop to help this man, what will happen to him? Radically different perspectives on what it means to serve. And so today, I want to share application. I think application is so incredibly important when we're reminded of what God's Word says. Here's the application. Four things. Number one, this won't shock you, but you may just need to be reminded. Every single day of your life, truth number one, you need to practice gratitude. You need to be thankful. Practice this every day. You have to be intentional about this. Y'all remember the little phrase that was popular? I've heard it over my life. Would you say that your life is like an attitude of gratitude? Have you heard that before? Oh man, I'm living with an attitude of gratitude. Or maybe instead, your attitude is crude and lewd and rude. I don't know which one. For some of us in the room, maybe if we're really honest, our attitude is self-serving. Self-serving rather than sacrificially serving. Psalm 118:29 says this, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Let me tell you what. You know what you're rarely going to see? At least this has been my experience. You will rarely see an individual who has a really ungrateful and bad attitude be the same person who is used by God to sacrificially serve other people. You don't see that. Because most of the time, the ungrateful person is often completely just deep into their own self-serving ways, and they struggle to get outside of that mindset so that they might consider someone else. So what needs to happen? What needs to happen? We begin to practice gratitude every single day. Now, let me kind of take a time out on that, and let me do a shift. And this is where I really think maybe the majority of you in this room, this is what you need to receive and hear. For some of you, this is your struggle. Your life, your activities, you are stretched so very thin that your busyness is impacting your ability to serve the Lord with gladness. And what God's word clearly commands us to do, here it is, you need to commit to a day of Sabbath. This is so important. It's one of the Ten Commandments. How can we ignore this? In all of our busyness, we need to understand and step into the command that we are called to be still and to rest, to know that He is God, and to celebrate the Sabbath. Here's what I think happens, honestly, in our world today. The majority of people, we rarely even think that it might be a sin that we are living such busy, hurried lives. We don't even think about it. In fact, what we do, you know what we do? We boast about it. We brag about all the busyness in our lives. Here's what your story may sound like. Oh, man, Kent, what a week. Man, I work was exhausting. I had to put in some extra hours. There was overtime. And then after that, you know, there were my kids. Here we go. Dance class, softball, soccer. And, you know, man, I got fantasy football. How am I supposed to find time to manage all that? I got that going on. And the guys in that league, they want to hang out and watch the game. And then on top of that, I got my hope group. And like my hope group wants me to be a part of that and hang with them. And then, oh my gosh, my wife just called me. I got to go buy the groceries. And she's going to be out tomorrow night. And that means I got to cook. I got to feed the kids. And by the way, they were invited to a birthday party both on Saturday and on Sunday. Is that real? And if this potentially is your life, let me say this to you in a spirit of love, friends, parents, guess what? You are in charge of the schedule. You are. Your 7-year-old is not in charge of the schedule. You are. And for some of you, you must learn how to say no to some of the extra activities so that you can say yes to Jesus. That's real. It may be that the reason you're struggling to serve well, the reason you're struggling to serve the Lord with gladness, deep breath, it's because you're burned out. You're exhausted. You're burned out. You're tired. And I'm saying it is up to you to do something about this. Commit to a day of Sabbath. Truth number three. This is just a friendly reminder. According to the text, according to God's word, according to the New Testament, we all have certain spiritual gifts. God has given us talents. And we are to serve other people within our God-given giftings and talents. Every one of us in this room are different. There are some of you right now who are the most uber-organized person on planet Earth. There are some of you who are crazy disorganized, right? Like we're all over the board. But if you're like the super organized person who just loves to take something that's chaotic and turn it into something that is order, do you realize that there are organizations, there are people you can serve to step into that, to use your gifting to help someone else? Some of you, like you literally have a heart for children. And if you have a heart for children, don't be the person to sign up, you know, to work at the food bank every Thursday night. Because moving around, you know, cans of corn is probably not going to be real rewarding for you. You can find a way to step into your gifting to serve, whether that's serving with kids right here in our own church, whether that's serving like you know, we have a partnership with Weary Housing and community servants. Every single day after school, they have an after-school program for kids. I mean, step into your gifting. What about this one? Man, this is as real as it gets. Maybe you have the heart of a teacher. You have the heart of a teacher. And you're also somebody who's really financially good helping people budget and come up with a plan. Like, I don't know what is going on right now. Ask Anna, ask Jenny, ask Andrew every single day of the week. Our church is bombarded with phone calls and people coming in off the street requesting financial assistance. Whether that's rent, whether that's, man, we need a hotel room, whether that's we need groceries. And so we got to get a grip on this. And our heart's desire is to come up with a team of people who can help people with the heart of a teacher, people who are gifted to love others well, who understand the importance of solid biblical financial planning. Man, to serve in that capacity, it's a huge need. Truth number four, we believe with all of our heart that the Bible teaches us when we serve others that it needs to begin with our oikos right here in our own community. Now, many people, we have new people every week come to Hope, and some of you are like, what did you just say? What? Oikos? Real quickly, just a reminder, it's a Greek word that means extended family. And here's what we believe at Hope. We know that the Bible teaches that all of us have this oikos. It's our family. It's our closest friends. It's our coworkers. It's our neighbors. We also believe that God is intentional in everything, and He allows us to have relationships with these people. And His plan is to use us to help them know about Christ, to encourage them, and watch that God might use us to serve them. Where do we get this? Well, we get it straight out of the New Testament. Many of you know the story of Jesus when He encounters the demon-possessed man who is living in a cemetery. Literally, he's crazy. Nobody knows what to do with him. Jesus comes, ministers to him, the demons are cast out, and the man says to Jesus, "Jesus, You have completely changed my life. I now know freedom." And He says, "I want to follow You. I want to get in the boat with You. I'm going everywhere You go." And Jesus says, here it is, "No, you're not. You're not." He says in the Greek, "Instead, I want you to go back to your oikos, to your friends, to your family, and I want you to tell them how the Lord has been good to you." That's it. This is our biblical model for how we make disciples. And so we start there, knowing that we're going to pray for these people and walk alongside them and encourage them and serve them. You know, one of the most, I was talking to Sean about this even last night, one of the most absolutely powerful, vivid memories I will never forget the rest of my life played out with a group of teenagers when I was a youth minister in Oklahoma City. I know I've shared this testimony with some of you, but many of you have never heard this. These two teenage girls in the middle of a summer youth ministry program showed up one day at the church where I was serving, and I didn't know anything about them. We get to know them, and over a short period of time, we find out that Rose and Amanda, two sisters, just about 2 years apart, they were homeless, living with their grandmother in the back of her station wagon. And so here I am, you know, new to youth ministry, new to ministry. And I'm like, well, okay, this is random. Don't know what to do with this. Didn't know I was going to potentially have some homeless teenagers in the youth group. And so time goes on, and God allowed us to love them and serve them well. But what I never saw coming was what the Lord did through two other teenage girls in our church, a girl named Valerie and a girl named Michelle, who at this time, they were probably about in the 10th grade. And Valerie and Michelle really led the rest of our youth group to do what I'm about to tell you that happened. They learned, these two girls in our church, 10th graders, learned that both Rose and Amanda's birthdays were their birthdays were real close together. And they said, you know what, Kent, would there be a way that we could organize a surprise birthday party for Rose and Amanda? I'm like, oh, yes, that is a phenomenal idea. And so they ran with it. I was not, it was so beautiful. We weren't in charge of it at all. And we just watched what played out as these two 10th grade girls in our church got other youth involved, got some adults involved. I mean, all the details. There was cake. There was ice cream. There were decorations. They all got together and put their money together to buy gifts, and it was incredible. So here's the plan. On this Sunday night, after the Sunday night church service, by the way, Sean and I were Rose and Amanda's personal chauffeurs, their taxi service. Everybody knew that they were going to be waiting to get in the van with us to go, you know, home, wherever that was. I feel like it changed about every 2 months. And so here we go, and I say to Rose and Amanda, hey, if y'all could come over here with me. Our church had a fellowship hall, and you know, the old school fellowship halls that had those partition walls that you could slide them open and closed, and they were supposed to prevent people being noisy, and they never worked. Those. And so everybody was ready. Decorations, cake, all the stuff. You know the routine. Lights are out. As I say, hey, Rose and Amanda, I forgot. Come on, I got to go over here. I forgot to do something. I got to grab this before we go. And like, here we go. And I know what's about to happen. And they're standing there. And, you know, as those doors are busted open, the lights are flipped on. And you know what you say? Surprise! And, you know, now here's like 60 or 70 people, teenagers, some of the adults in our church, some of the volunteer youth workers breaking out into the happy birthday song. And I'm standing there next to Rose and Amanda, and I'm just looking at their faces as tears just start rolling down their cheeks. Ah, they were overwhelmed, a good kind of happy. Happy tears, and we go in and, you know, all the stuff, open the gifts, eat the cake. It's a great night. And that later that night, they're in the van. Here we go, taking them home. And out of nowhere, they're just like saying, guys, this is the first time in our lives anyone has taken the time to throw us a real birthday party. And my heart sank. But at the same time, to this day, when I think about impactful, life-changing moments, that's it. When two teenage girls decided we're going to do what Jesus tells us to do, we are going to serve one another. And all I'm saying to you this morning, friends, like if 10th grade girls can do that, you can too. You can step into that and be used for the glory of God. It may not be all that, like, oh, wow, my story's going to be told by a pastor 20 years later. That doesn't matter, because you're just going to be faithful to the Lord to be used. It could be the smallest of situations, but it will have an eternal impact. Serve the Lord with gladness. Now, you're here today, And there may be all kinds of things on your heart. We know that. And so today, as we move into this time of response, and then we're going to have some baptisms here in a moment, man, know this, you're invited to pray. You're invited to this altar to pray. As we stand in a moment to sing, if you just want to be alone with God, just you and a friend, you and your family, you come to this side of the altar and pray. No one will bother you. We'll leave you alone, just you and the Lord. If today you're coming and saying, you know, Kent, man, there's something going on in my life, listen, come to this side of the altar, and you coming to this side means we're ready. And someone, we will step into this moment and come and pray over you and pray with you. All right? God, thank you for this morning. We want to be obedient to you in everything. And today, God, we've been reminded of the importance of serving one another. Man, we don't want to be self-centered. We don't. We want to honor you. We want to be used for your kingdom's glory. God, I'm really thankful that there are a ton of people at Hope Fellowship Church that get this, that step into serving the Lord with gladness. God, continue to use them for your glory. And God, for those of us who are struggling a bit with this, man, let this be a day where we look back and say, you know what? There it is. Sunday, September 17th, 2023, God spoke to me and reminded me, hey, I want to use you in the kingdom work for my glory. God, may we serve with gladness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.